Greetings, one and all. Welcome back. It's been a few seconds since the last episode, but I am back to discuss with you the Ethiopic text at Revelation 16:5 as part of an ongoing series of responses to Nick Sayers, with whom I've been discussing his book. The book is this one, Revelation 16:5, Beza's expansion of the rare Nomen Sacrum form of Jehovah and I Am in the Final Triadic Declaration. And we have come now to section 3.15, that's 3.15, I guess I should say. And that's the 1549 Ethiopic. Unfortunately, for Nick, it's a really, tiny point, but the subject heading there says Ethiopic instead of Ethiopic. The O is in the wrong place there. Something to fix for the next edition, if there will be a next edition. In this section, he starts off by saying, as pointed out by Hoskier in concerning the text of the Apocalypse, the Ethiopic Bible reads, shalt be. This was first printed in Rome in 1549 and later in Walton's Polyglot of 1657. In the Nestle-Aland apparatus, it's known as the abbreviation eth.ro for Ethiopic Rome. The below is from Walton's Ethiopic Bible, followed by a Latin interpretation of the Ethiopic. He provides a snippet of the Walton's Polyglot text of the Ethiopic and the Walton's Polyglot Latin translation of that Ethiopic. He says the date of the first version of the ancient Ethiopic, also spelled Ethiopic, also known as Ge'ez and Amharic, come back to that in a second, is not precisely known, but the fourth century is a common approximation. It has been judged that the first Ethiopic translation was made from the Greek language. In the picture below, Herman Hoskier cites and shalt be in the Ethiopic version with the following Latin translation, qui fuisti et eris, which translates, which has been and shall be. And then Hoskier, he provides a little quotation or a little snippet from Hoskier and says that Hoskier points out that the Aeth, A-E-T-H, Ethiopic, has et futuris es, or and shalt be. In the preface of the King James Version in 1611, Miles Smith mentions how Chrysostom spoke concerning the Ethiopic. So St. Chrysostom, that lived in St. Jerome's time, gives evidence with him. The doctrine of St. John, says he, did not in such sort, as the philosophers did, vanish away, but the Syrians, Egyptians, Indians, Persians, Ethiopians, and infinite other nations being barbarous peoples translated into their mother tongue and have learned to be true philosophers. Smith later said, so Postel affirms that in his travel he saw the Gospels in the Ethiopian tongue, and Ambrose Thysius alleged that the Psalter of the Indians, which he testifies to have been set forth by Potkin in Syrian characters. Many years before Christianity, Judaism was introduced, this is now back to Nick, many years before Christianity, Judaism was introduced into Ethiopia from the time of the visit of the Queen of Sheba to Solomon. Recent discoveries of manuscripts dating to the 4th to 6th centuries suggest the presence of Christianity before the 4th century, along with the possibility of Ge'ez translations. In the 4th century, Christianity had become the state religion during the reign of King Ezana, first half of the 4th century, with St. Frumentius as bishop. Ge'ez itself changed with the introduction of vowels and the reversal of the direction, writing from right to left to right. The Ethiopic version proves White wrong yet again. He claims no one knew of the reading, but this clearly shows that people did know it. It shows that 33 years before the word Islamnos saw the ink of Beza, it was sitting in Rome in the Ethiopic Bible at Revelation 16:5, but it seems that this information is not good enough for White, who rashly claimed on his DL program that Beza didn't know of the reading. We shall examine this claim in the next chapter. So, I pause. I see I've got some comments coming in. Oh, hello to Algo, who's watching from abroad or listening from abroad. Appreciate it. Thanks, Algo. So, a couple of points here in response. First, we'll come back to this question of whether or not it proves anybody right or wrong. Then we'll also talk about this, what was in the ink, and whether or not Beza had access to it. So whether Beza had access to it is an interesting question. We probably won't get into that a lot now. And if if Nick brings up that point, I don't remember if he does bring it up later in here. I know he sometimes brought up some comments about it in view of a connection to Tremellius, I believe. So I think he'll say that Tremellius has some connection to the printing of this Ethiopic text. But I'll address that. Even if there is some connect, there is a connection between Beza and Tremellius, but even if there's some further connection between Tremellius and this text, it doesn't say very much. But ultimately, I don't think all of this will particularly matter once we see the rest of the discussion. What else? As far as when Christianity came to Ethiopia, the middle of the 4th century is the usual time that's predicted as the kind of advent of a significant infiltration of Christianity into Ethiopia, with Frumentius being one of the missionaries there who served there. I don't think he was a bishop, but you know, that's what Nick says here. I could be wrong about that. It's neither here nor there for our purposes of this discussion. Whether or not the Queen of Sheba has any connection, again, she certainly had a connection to Solomon, and she, you know, came back to Ethiopia. Whether that's the same Ethiopia in a meaningful way as the 4th century Ethiopia is a different question. There's a question of how the language changed. The language did change, although it seems to have changed before the entrance of Christianity. And the change was not only a change of going from the right to left, like Arabic and Hebrew, but to left to right, but also adding in vowels into the consonantal characters. So like Hebrew that has just consonantal characters, Hebrew in the, I think it was like around the 6th century or so, added vowel points. Whereas already in the 4th century, the Ge'ez language was adding vocalizations, these vowel, not exactly vowel points, but modifications of the consonants to indicate which vowel goes with that consonant. So it could be without any marks, and there's basically 7 different forms of every consonant in the Ge'ez language. He says that Ge'ez and Amharic are the same thing. They're not. The Amharic uses the Ge'ez characters and some additional characters. Amharic, and there's a couple other languages in Ethiopia and Eritrea that are closely related to Ge'ez, but like closely meaning like between 40 and 60% similar to Ge'ez, something like that. Ethiopic or Abyssinian sometimes is mentioned as another name for the language, but usually Ge'ez is the preferred term now, either Ge'ez or Ethiopic. We'll get into his text and what Hoskier said. Hoskier is a great scholar. He's not a great scholar of Ethiopic. He's a great scholar of the collation of Revelation and some other books as well. Quite an impressive scholar, but not an expert in Ethiopic. And he was working from somewhat limited basis, primarily. I think it's safe to say he was working from Latin translations and hadn't carefully studied the Ethiopic himself, which is fine. But just keep in mind, there are issues when you see two things that look the same in English. That doesn't mean that they're the same in the base language, because there's different ways to arrive at the same expression in English from a base language. And that, yeah, people tend to use this transitive property, A equals B, C equals B, therefore A equals C. And that can work in some situations. It doesn't always work, especially not when you're talking about trying to get back to the Greek, represented by the Ge'ez, represented by Latin. And now for us who don't speak Latin very fluently, back to English. So we have English, Latin, Ge'ez, Greek that we have to get back to the Greek on. It's not a straightforward path. However, in order to guide us through this issue, because it's a complex issue and because I enjoy these type of things, I have actually done the research and happy to present and share my research on this particular topic. And hopefully it will be of benefit to folks. I have it posted on my blog, so the link is in the description. So feel free to go and read this at your leisure. I know that's what most people are doing, is leisure reading about Ge'ez. I I'm just jumping on that bandwagon of all the big, what's the right term? This massive trend of everyone looking for reading about geese. So let me focus on the actual issue. The actual issue is this. In the last decade or so, the Ethiopic has sometimes been brought out as an alleged versional witness to Beza's amended reading of Revelation 65. Now, I say it's in the last decade that it's been sometimes brought out, but of course it has been brought out before that. Hosker is an example of somebody who's come before the last decade. I'm not saying only in the last decade, but I am saying in the last decade. If I see errors in here, I hope I'll have a chance to go in back and correct them before this catches that huge viral trend of all the people who like to study geese in their spare time. So the question is this. Instead of Hoosius, Beza argued the text should say, oh, ho esomenos. My Greek pronunciation is just awful. All you have to do is ask Christian McShoffrey, or there's a few others who have noted how bad my pronunciation. It is terrible. So it's not even just like it's terrible because I'm using the Erasmian pronunciation instead of the modern Greek pronunciation or vice versa. It's utterly terrible. And my pronunciation of geese, you're not going to hear me make a pronunciation of geese. I can't speak geese. I can't speak Amharic. I think it's a beautiful, I think the alphabet of Amharic is a really beautiful thing with the combination of consonants and vowels as they've done, and the large number of consonants and the large number of vowels. I think it's beautiful, but I don't speak the language. So, but we can get through this without me speaking the language. So the question is, what about this substitution variant? It's a substitution variant. That's what it is. It's saying that the text, instead of saying esomenos, should say hosios. Now, this is one difference between Beza's text and the modern critical text. It's not the only difference between Beza's text and the modern critical text. It's not the only difference between those texts. That's important for Nick's overall argument. Keep in mind, this book, it contains an overall argument, not just an argument based on the Ethiopic. It doesn't all stand or fall on the Ethiopic. But the Ethiopic is one of the arguments that's a frequent go-to in this book and in some other people who are defending this based on the book or based on Hosker. Or who knows what else. I mean, I'm sure there's other people out there. KJV Today, I think, has an article on this as well. But the question is this. Was Beza right to make the substitution of esomenos for hosios in Revelation 16:5? You can just visually see that in this particular, these are all lowercase, but you can see how similar there are. There's a lot of similarities. There's a sigma, omicron. There's another omicron, sigma. You can see how this is sort of remotely somewhat similar between these two words, and you could kind of imagine a corruption of one into the other somehow happening over the years. So is Beza right? Now, Beza may or may not have this idea in his mind. I don't think that Nick is saying it's just a corruption of sight or sound or anything like that, but anyway, is this substitution, esomenos for osios, is that correct? And let's turn to the Ethiopic to figure that out. But first, here's a little bit of background on the reception or not of Beza's emendation. So around 1611, the King James Version translators edited the Bishop's Bible at Revelation 16:5. That's what their task was. They were going through the Bishop's Bible and editing it. They weren't doing a scratch translation of the New Testament. They were editing the Bishop's Bible. And they were experts, so they started with something good and were trying to make something even better, which is what we should be doing as well. When we see the King James Version, which is excellent, we can make it even better. That's why I have in the opening credits, or whatever you call it, the opening trailer of the episode, can we improve the King James Version? Because that's what we should be aiming for, not trying to tear it down, but trying to improve it, make it better. So what about the Bishop's Bible, 1568? You can see here it says, "And I heard the angel of the waters say, Lord, which art and wast, thou art righteous and that holy one, because thou hast given such judgments." So that corresponds to this Greek with, not with oesomenos, but this one with oesomenos, because you can see that holy one is oesomenos, that holy one. Now, it does have the chi, the and you can see it says, and that holy one. And so the chi is there as well. But, you know, that's not the substitution issue that Beza was focused on, whether or not the chi was there. I'm just mentioning that out because it turns out to be important later on. Even in the 1599 Geneva Bible, printed after Beza's emendation of the Greek, the Geneva Bible continued to follow the original Greek. Here they have, thou art just, which art and wast, and holy. So, and holy is, again, the translation of Hosius, not Hosomenos. And you can even see the notes. You can see it better on the website. But anyway, the notes also don't even mention this issue or address it. The Elsevier printers, a family of printers descending from Ludwig, I think that's the right way to say it, Elsevier, reverted to the Greek original from Beza's reading in the 1624, but then returned to Beza's reading in the 1633. Now, I know Nick has some discussion of why this happened, but nevertheless, in 1641, they returned back again to the Greek original. By Greek original, I do mean Hosius. Whether or not the chi should be original or not, it's not my point. But the point is, Hosius, as opposed to Hosomenos, it was in Beza's 1582. I think it was also in his 1598. Then it was dropped by the Elseviers in 1624, returned in 1633, and then in 1641, and all the subsequent editions that I could find, and I'm not sure, maybe there's some edition I haven't found yet that's different, but the 1641, 1654, 1658 Lear's printings, they have the same Greek original Hosius, as you can see on the screen. Likewise, if you dig into the Walton's Polyglot, 1657, Bishop Fell's text, 1675, John Mill's text, Wettstein's text, all these texts, they all have the Hosius, the exception being Scrivener's 1894 Textus Receptus, but that's not because Scrivener thought that the original should be Hosius, but just that he was trying to provide the Greek corresponding to the King James Version, and the King James Version has followed Beza by putting shall be and shall be instead of and the Holy One. So we could go on. The point's straightforward. New Testament textual scholars after Beza generally were not persuaded as to this change, and the only reason for the inclusion of this reading in today's Textus Receptus edition, the blue Textus Receptus that you can buy, is because it happens to be the Greek text that corresponds to the 1611 King James Version, not because the Reformed churches received this text for a lengthy time. That said, the Dutch 1637 did adopt that reading, and many English editions followed the King James Version. Also, translations were made from the King James Version, which followed the King James Version. And there were some other language versions, like the Spanish Valera 1602, which I think did follow this, and the Osterwald French version 1744 that followed it. There are some others as well, I believe. And I haven't carefully studied in each case to see if any of those have textual notes or something like that. Maybe if someone's interested, they can dig into that further. The point, though, is whether or not it deserves the title Textus Receptus for this particular reading, since it wasn't very well received compared to most other places where Beza's New Testament is exactly the same as the New Testament we even have today. And many other places where it was the same throughout the 1600s and is different now because of the influence of more emphasis on the older text. Nevertheless, what about the Ethiopic? Did the Ethiopic support Beza's reading? That's important. So, what about the Ethiopic text? Well, not everyone has, you know, all of their time spent focusing on the Ethiopic text. So, you could dig into the 1856 Introduction to the Critical Study and Knowledge of the Holy Scriptures, which provides an excellent introduction to the Ethiopic version, sometimes also spelled with an A, and also sometimes called the Abyssinian. In a nutshell, it's believed that that Ethiopic version was produced around the middle of the 4th century as the result of evangelistic efforts of Frumentius and Idesus. Although Horn doesn't mention it, it appears that it was around the same time that script began to be consistently written from left to right, after some centuries of being right to left, actually following a period where it was written according to a boustrophedon method, which is from right to left one line, then back right to left, and then back left to right, like an ox plowing a field. Can you imagine how hard that would be to read? Well, apparently our grandcestors also didn't care for that, and generally either went left to right or right to left. The Ge'ez language had a switch, and this is about the same time that vocalization was added, which suggests, but doesn't prove, that the language was kind of dying out, and the need for adding vocalization into the written text is because people weren't able to just read the consonantal text without the vowel pointings. We're calling them vowel pointings because I'm more familiar with Hebrew than I am with Ge'ez, and Hebrew uses vowel pointings. They're not pointings, they're actually modifications of the consonantal characters. The point is that these are added around the middle of the 4th century, around the time of the Christian influence on Ethiopia. And there are some variety of opinions about how the translation of the New Testament came to be. There's some stories that it was actually originally translated from the Arabic, but Horn rejects that idea, and I think Metzger also rejects that idea. There's also some question about when it was translated. Some say as early as the 4th century or even earlier, and some scholars say maybe it was like actually the 5th or 6th century that it was actually translated, and they would connect it with the missionary activity of the Nine Saints. There's a link there if you want to read more about the Nine Saints. If so, then maybe these Garima Gospel manuscripts, which have now been dated with, I think, some kind of carbon dating or something like that, back to that, around that era, these might be some like original translation work, if indeed they are, but they're only the Gospels. I don't remember if I get into it here, but the Gospels are translated earlier and better than some of the rest of the Bible in Ethiopic. So that's one issue. It's not all done at once, and it's not all done necessarily with the same quality. The first printed edition of any part of the Ethiopic text was a Psalter printed in 1513. Google Books suggests 1518. I'm not sure which is right, but it's mislabeled as Chaldee at the time. I don't know why it was mislabeled that way. And I think we heard something about that briefly in the material that we read from Nick. But in 1513, there was this Psalter printed. It was Ethiopic, but it was called Chaldee. It isn't Chaldee. It is a Semitic language like Arabic or Hebrew. In any event, that doesn't include Revelation. But in 1548, the New Testament, except for Paul's epistles and Hebrews, were printed in Rome, and the remainder was printed in 1549. Peter the Ethiopian and some others that were working on this project relied on three manuscripts, two from the 15th century and one from the 16th century, and those manuscripts are apparently still available to be reviewed. Horn says that others have described the Roman edition as far from accurate and criticized that report. But Horn also criticized a report that says that a large part of the book of Acts was filled up with a translation back into Ethiopian from Latin and Greek. And this is actually a little bit of a problem if we're trying to use the Ethiopic for anything that's before the 16th century. We know that this is the state of an Ethiopian text in the 16th century, but it's hard to know much before that. Anyway, we have the original manuscripts that it was built on, so we could actually go to those, and we don't have to rely on the Roman text. I mean, maybe the scholars have to rely on it because they don't have easy access to these manuscripts, but in theory, at least, they have access to these manuscripts and could refer to them instead of having to rely on this Ethiopic Roman printing. So it was criticized as being far from accurate. We can check that now. And when it comes to our text, we're not going to see a problem with accuracy, at least not in the sections, and in terms of accuracy, in terms of representing the Ethiopic text. Now, I question when people said it was far from accurate, I wonder if what they meant was that it's too often following Alexandrian readings as opposed to Byzantine readings. If that's what they meant, that's not a problem that Peter the Ethiopian introduced. That's just a problem that the Ethiopian was copied centuries before the Byzantines, the bulk of the Byzantine manuscripts were made, and therefore represents an earlier text. If that's the issue, then calling it inaccurate is just, you know, a distraction. There was a, in 1652, there was a printing of the Ethiopic text by in Walton's Polyglot, which had multiple language texts in there, including Greek, Arabic, Ethiopic. I don't remember all the languages that were included, but multiple languages were included. It was a massive work. And he used the same Roman text, although in some cases he made some typos, essentially, of that text. And he did provide a Latin translation of the Ethiopic. That was the work of, I mentioned it below, but I think his name was Dudley Loftus. And Dudley Loftus is the one who translated. His translation was criticized. But again, I think it's hard to know whether his translation was criticized because people didn't like what it said, or if his translation was criticized on grounds of merit. It's hard for me to distinguish. 100 years later, Christoph August Bode did his own allegedly improved Latin translation. As we'll see, it's not miles apart from Loftus's translation. It's quite similar. It's a little bit more sophisticated, but it's 100 years later. And then another 70 years later, Platt printed the Gospels from a collation of manuscripts, but the purpose seems to have been just to provide the Ethiopic church or Ethiopian church with this. And he didn't, although he took some notes on his collation, he didn't really provide good critical notes on the text as a whole. And his notes, to the extent we have them, are really limited to the Gospels, I think. So we don't have his notes on Revelation. My own take is that I'm not totally happy with his work. We don't have to rely much on it. I did include it in the survey for completeness. Horn believes that the Ethiopic is a direct translation of the Greek, but that the person who did this couldn't have been a Greek himself because of a lot of translation errors along the way. And you know, I'm not sure how to criticize these translators. There's translators who are doing an overall excellent job, but that they do make mistakes. And you know, I guess the point is, Horn's suggesting that the translator, because he made these mistakes, was working from a Greek text, and that seems like a reasonable conclusion. But that he didn't know Greek very well is like, I think it's demanding a lot. So I'm not sure what to say. I don't think it, I think this incompetent translator is just too unfair. I think there's a lot of challenges in translating between Ge'ez and Greek, and that the translator didn't provide a super literal word for word translation of the Greek, but that he overall did a fine job, and that the gospel is not lost or anything like that. But that said, he says that he quotes Platt as saying that the translation has a loose and paraphrastic translation, including so many repetitions, continually representing the same phrase by two different expressions immediately succeeding one another. And when these are not connected together by the requisite intermediate particles, of course, a great confusion is introduced. So this part, I think Platt makes some good point, which is that it's like, you know, in English, we have the King James Version, which is fairly literal. It's not always literal word for word, but it's fairly literal word for word. And then we have translations that are like at the other extreme, like the Message, where it's just like trying to give you the general idea inspired by the text, but not really a translation of the text. Then you have things that are towards that end that are quite dynamic. And then there's ones that are less dynamic. I don't know exactly where the NIV, for example, fits on that scale, but the NIV is at times a dynamic equivalent translation, and that tends to be its translation methodology. And it's sometimes criticized as being too dynamic, but in this case, it seems like the Ge'ez translator, or translators, we'll come to that in a second, that they did tend to be a bit periphrastic and loose in their translation, sometimes even like the, what's that one? The Amplified Bible, where it will give like two or three different translations of the same thing and just put them both all together. Sometimes that type of issue crops up in this text, which could create a problem, especially for our purposes for Revelation 16:5. Because in our text, we have something that's a little bit repetitive already. So you'd be concerned about the possibility of introduced repetition clouding or muddying the waters about original repetition versus introduced repetition. So there's some hints that are made in the 1800s, apparently, that there were multiple versions that were somehow harmonized together because of the idea that maybe this expansion came because the scribe saw two different versions and tried to harmonize them into one. Horn dismisses that idea. I tend to dismiss it as well. I think there's good reason, based on the work of Hoffman later, that to think that this is not the case. Horn suggests that the translation might be the work of different translators because there's a different quality of translation outside the Gospels. And I tend to agree with that point. That tends to make sense. The Gospels were probably translated first and separately, and then the other may have been translated even by a different person. Horn says it's a mixed text, meaning there's Byzantine readings and Alexandrian readings. And the version is of interest on the question of the long ending of Mark. It's not a point I'm going to get into today, but something for kind of future reference. To the extent people think, oh, the Ethiopic, you got to go with the Ethiopic, it's the best. Well, it's going to have an impact on your view of the long ending of Mark, possibly. Horn notes that the use of the Ethiopic version for textual criticism began, or nearly so, with Walton's Polyglot, as the Latin translation made that text accessible. And that's right. So there is no reason to think that Beza or other people of his era before Walton's Polyglot, so like it was, you know, around 100 years from the time that Peter the Ethiopian printed that text until Walton's Polyglot published a Latin translation, it really was largely inaccessible to European scholars, which were almost all of the scholars working on this text. They didn't know Ethiopic, and therefore the vast majority of them didn't know Ethiopic and couldn't tell you what the text said, because it's not written in Greek characters, it's not written in Latin characters, it's not written in Chaldean characters, it's written in Ge'ez characters, which have some remote resemblance to Greek or Hebrew letters, but it's remote enough that it's not straightforward to just read it. So it's not even straightforward to just sound it out. Horn, writing in 1856, kind of brought us up to the time of Platt. There's a longer history. I've kind of published it here. It begins with Chaim ben David Schwartz from 1490 to 1549, who published that first Psalter, then Tafsva Zion, brother Peter the Ethiopian, and his companions, other monks named Paul and Bernardus for the Europeans, but Tansa Awald and Za Salase, those are the, the Ethiopian names of those three monks. They came together. They could speak Ethiopian, and they could help the printers print the text by making sure that the Ethiopian words were correct, but they didn't know how to typeset. So the typesetters couldn't speak Ethiopian, and the Ethiopians couldn't speak Latin, or they could speak some Latin, but they couldn't do the composing or typesetting themselves. So they were reliant on two teams of people working together. And I think for what they were trying to do, they did a great job. Then we come along with Brian Walton, 1600 to 1661, who provides this polyglot, including Dudley Loftus of Dublin. So you can see, being an Irish translator, and the text not really fitting with the received text at the time, he kind of got criticized for doing a bad translation instead of just instead of these English scholars just saying, well, maybe it's an interesting source. But it is what it is. So Bode, he's another scholar. He provides the translation of the New Testament. He also has separate, he did the Gospel of Matthew first separately, but later on the whole New Testament. Platt comes along beginning of the 1800s and does his version, which is just in Ethiopic. There's links to all these things on the blog. Dillman comes along in the late 1800s. He's a German Orientalist, and he's known as a commentator, but he actually provided a lot of great contributions to understanding the Ethiopic language, including a grammar, which was then subsequently translated into English in 1907 and is quite useful for our purposes of understanding Ethiopic now. Dillman is still cited by contemporary scholars when they're doing, you know, works in Ethiopic. I believe they continue to cite him as one of the sources. His lexicon is there and includes a Latin index. If you want to do a reverse search, you want to see how could something be translated into Ethiopic, and this Crestomathia Ethiopica. So subsequently, Marcel Cohen, late 1800s to late 1900s, was an expert in Semitic languages, especially Ethiopic, and he also includes some discussion of the Ethiopic language. And he's important partly because he's the one who trained, or mentored at least, Wolf Leslau, who is an expert in the Ethiopian language and author of many books, including a comparative dictionary of Ge'ez and a concise dictionary of Ge'ez, both of which are excellent resources and are definitely used still today. He brings us up through near the end of the 20th century. There's also some other great scholars that have done work in this field, including Monica Devins, who has a concordance of the Psalms in the Ethiopic version. It's very valuable. There's this Traces Lexicon Project, a concordance of the Ethiopian Bible, which is updated last in 2021. Daniel de Cosin has done a corpus of Ge'ez words found in the Book of Enoch, Henoch, as it's put here, but I believe it's just the same thing as Enoch. And they, although this is not formally a concordance like Monica Devin's work, it serves a similar purpose, and it's also quite informative in terms of helping to better understand the Ge'ez language. There's a Bible in Ge'ez. There's the Ge'ez Bible as well, a different website. And Kurt Nickum has an interesting article called Apocalypse Now, the Ethiopic, which I think Nick will get a chuckle out of the Apocalypse Now. I'm not sure, but I think so. The subtitle is The Ethiopic Version of Revelation 50 Years After Hoffman. I may have typoed something here. But in any event, he's updating the research on the Book of Revelation 50 years from Hoffman. So 2017 is 50 years from 1967. There's also an Ethiopic grammar by Mercer from 1920, which is also helpful. And then there's additional details that you can find in Bruce Metzger's The Early Versions of the New Testament, Their Origin, Transmission, and Limitations. From my own standpoint, the Ethiopic text poses a number of challenges. First, the Ge'ez character the character set itself is problematic. It may have some, it is probably connected to the Paleo-Canaanite script, same as Greek is and lots of other languages are. And it probably is derived from ancient South Arabian, not Arabic, but ancient South Arabian. And there's many similar names and sounds of the letters. There's something like a Daleth and a Gimel and so forth. And there's use of vowel markings of the consonants, these consonantal changes to indicate vowels. If you know Hebrew and Greek, you could probably learn Ethiopic, but it's not like it's highly similar and you can just learn a few different words and you're good to go. It is a different, separate language. I think Rosetta Stone put Amharic as a Category 3 language, I think for English speakers, out of 4, so not the most difficult, but also not, you know, far from being the easiest. And Amharic is a modern language. Ge'ez is an ancient language that's related to Amharic. That's why I mentioned Amharic. Another challenge is some of the resources that are out there will transliterate the Ge'ez words into Roman letters, which is helpful if you're trying to sound out the words and you don't read Ge'ez at all. And people do this with Greek as well. A lot of times you'll see people put the Greek word and then they'll put the English transliteration right afterwards. A lot of people like this. It's great for introductory works or reference works that for people who don't speak the language, but it can be really hard to understand when you're trying to read through different reference books that are using, some are using the Ge'ez characters, some are not. Some are just using the English, the phonetically equivalent English. And there's a couple of different phonetizations, I think that's the right word, for Ge'ez. I don't know how much that's standardized, but there I've seen a couple of different ways that people have done it. That just makes it more complicated to process. So in other words, there's a steep learning curve, and it's not easy to get up it, and it's not easy to get acquainted with Ge'ez, which is partly why probably Beza didn't know it and wouldn't have had a Ge'ez Bible next to him as a reference source, because he didn't speak it, and because it would have served him exactly the same as a Chinese Bible would have served him, which is to say, not at all. He wouldn't be benefited by having it, not even a little bit, because he couldn't sound out the letters, much less read the words. That said, there are some nice things. The Ge'ez characters are now in the Unicode set, so you can copy and paste them. You can do digital searching on them and so forth. It's quite handy. I think it's probably thanks to the fact that modern Amharic is spoken in Ethiopia and outside Ethiopia, but primarily spoken in Ethiopia. And therefore, there was a push to include those characters, including the Ge'ez characters, in the Unicode set. And they're done separately, not as diacritical modifications of a base character. So if they're, let's say, a kaf character can have seven different vowel forms, there's actually seven different Unicode characters, not just one, and seven ways to modify the one. So let's see. In some ways, this is a lot like the issues that arise with Greek or Hebrew. In fact, I should add, the language itself, to perform declension or conjugation, and some scholars would say you don't really decline the words in Ge'ez, but anyway, there's prefixes that are used for some things and suffixes used for other things. Including adding on conjunctions and prepositions, and the use of those conjunctions and prepositions is used to understand the language better. There's character, some of these are characteristics of languages like Greek or Hebrew, but it has its own rules, it has its own forms and so forth. And, it's not easy for someone like myself to just kind of pick it up. I'm really thankful for scholars who do pick it up and use it. I think an example was that I was recently working with on was Stephen Shoemaker learned Ge'ez and translated from Ge'ez as part of his work in connection with the bodily assumption of Mary materials that are out there. Some of them are written in Ge'ez, and evidently he provided translations that he himself did. That's really impressive to me. It's not easy to pick up languages, at least not for me. By way of an example, the second person singular masculine is indicated by the suffix kaf, sometimes transliterated as ka or ka, as opposed to a second person singular feminine, which is with a kaf modified so that it says ki or ki instead of ka or ka. The difference between those is the difference between a kaf character with no vowel modification versus one with this lower right corner. It's the fifth out of seven forms that a kaf can take. And I have on the screen here, you can't see it very well here, but if you go to the blog, I promise you can make it bigger and you can see it a little bit better. But you can see the difference is the kaf that the cursor is pointing at the cursor is pointing at here is the masculine, and this very similar one is the feminine. It just has this extra little, I don't know what to call it, but this vowel marker in the bottom right corner, and that tells you that it's a ki, not a ka sound, a different vowel going with the same consonant. Interestingly, Ge's numbers are not Arabic numerals. They're not Gizic numerals, if that's a term. They are actually Greek numbers, possibly borrowed directly from Greek or via Coptic. But my point here is not to teach everybody Gies. I've been meaning to use this pun, and I apologize, but I can't resist at least using it once. I'm not a Gies whiz. And this point is not to make any of you that. I would say that in terms of background, the current go-to text is Hoffman's text, which is it's 1967, so it's over 50 years old now. I think that's the most recent critical text of Revelation, and it's based on 26 manuscripts. Now there's over 100 known manuscripts. Some of those are even older than those used by Hoffman. But keep in mind it's not very old. These aren't competitive with New Testament Greek ancient manuscripts. Like the most ancient Greek New Testament manuscripts are much older, we think, than the vast majority of all Greek manuscripts, and also almost all of the Greek manuscripts of Revelation are not that old. They're maybe like 13th century, 14th century, something like that. They're not super old. And you can go and you can read, he has some discussion of his sources. Also, this Apocalypse Now article, I think, describes it a bit more. There may be some 10th century manuscripts or something like that out there. There's been some redating of some of the manuscripts since Hoffman. So, yes. Yes, I'm not a geez whiz, or that's the joke. Metzger, I'm not, but yeah, just trying to make a pun here to keep the mood going. Metzger in 1977 notes that John Mill, in his 1707, identified some Ethiopic readings in which the Latin translation of the Ethiopic found in Walton's Polyglot agrees with Codex Alexandrinus. And in a few places, sided with Ethiopic either alone or with very few other witnesses. However, at Revelation 16:5, Mill has, as you can see, Hosius, here we go, there's the pointer, or that's not the pointer, here we go, here's the pointer. Hosius is here in his text, meaning that he went with the Greek, what I call the Greek original, although he does have this chi, which I would disagree with, But anyway, he has the Chi and the Hohosius, not Hosomenos. And you'll notice that I included all his critical notes at this place, and he doesn't cite the Ethiopic for this text. He doesn't cite it for Hosomenos. Just trying to see, yeah. He doesn't cite it at all for verse 5 for any of the readings or anything like that. But I will note that in the previous verse, you'll see that he does cite it in one place, and this is how he cites it, A-E, this A-E ligature, T-H-I-O-P, period, Ethiop, and it's cited here, it's also cited here. So you can see he is regularly making use of it. He didn't make use of it for finding a different reading in Revelation 16:5. As one shouldn't, and I'll get into why one shouldn't in a bit. So I've included the notes just to be thorough there, but also for your interest if you're interested in such things. Metzger notes that Hosker found 50 places in Paul's epistles, not even counting Hebrews, where the Ethiopic is nearly the only witness that agrees with P46. The idea being that potentially the Ethiopic Paul's epistles might be a representative of quite an early text of Revelation, which would mean that we should be considering the Ethiopic as representing an early Greek manuscript tradition, and therefore maybe give it a little bit more weight than we might otherwise be inclined to do based on the fact that some of these manuscripts are not that old by comparison to the Greek manuscripts. There's some discussion here that Metzger says, Hoffman says that the Apocalypse, the Revelation, was translated between 550 and 650, in other words, mid-6th century to mid-7th century, by a different translator than the Gospels. And he also says that there's a lot of contamination in the text, and that includes this word, which I had not known. This word is Schlimm Verbesserungen. I'm sure I butchered the word. Schlimm Verbesserungen. Schlimm Verbesserungen, which means bad improvement. So apparently, you know, people tried to improve the text. They did a poor job of it. And there's been some bad corrections of the text over the centuries, including changes that came from the Coptic and the Arabic. There's Arabic changes to the text that appear in their textual tradition after Peter the Ethiopian's printed text, and therefore obviously don't affect Peter the Ethiopian's text, but just kind of for interest, they continued to do handwritten copies in Ethiopia after Peter the Ethiopian printed his text. It didn't immediately take over there. Within Metzger's book, Hoffman himself offers a chapter section. This is in a 1977 book. Hoffman offers a section on limitations of the Ethiopic in representing Greek. This begins at page 240. I'm sorry for laughing. I saw this comment. Bad corrections like the cleanup job after Pope Sixtus V. They actually did a good job of cleaning up after him, I think, but his corrections were bad corrections. Let's see. So the limitations that Hoffman in Metzger's book describes are phonetics. In other words, although there's a lot of phonetic range in Geese, it doesn't always line up well with Greek. So transliteration of words is not something you can really count on, that it's going to tell you what the Greek original was. And that is what it is. We would have that same problem in English. In fact, that's something that Scrivener seemed to have run into when he was trying to figure out what was the original Greek text for the King James Version. Sometimes the phonetic similarity test may have misled Scrivener. In other words, some of the English words may be more phonetically similar to one Greek version than to another Greek version, but actually the King James translators were probably just following a traditional English spelling of those words, or a traditional English transliteration, not necessarily following one Greek over the other. So, and that doesn't affect our particular verse because there's no transliteration going on in Revelation 16:5 or the other parallel texts, at least not in the parts that were of interest to us. However, the other ones are morphology, syntax, or morphology and syntax. I should edit this at some point. Hopefully I'll remember. But morphology is a bigger issue. Under morphology, there's numerous issues, including Ethiopic having only masculine and feminine, but not neuter. So like some other languages, Ethiopic, Greek has masculine, neuter, and feminine, but Ethiopic only has masculine and feminine. So some details of which Greek word were used will get lost in translation, sort of necessarily. There are ways to express things, but that depends on the skill of the translator and the intent to try to preserve that kind of detail for us later, which the translator is not always up for. And as we said, some of these translations seem a little paraphrastic. Well, another reason is Ethiopic lacks both definite and indefinite articles. On this point, we can criticize Ethiopic for that, but that's the same problem that Latin has as well. There's no an or the in Latin, in Russian. There's lots of languages that don't use articles. And English has articles. We don't use them just the same way as Greek does, though. So even that, there's not a one-to-one correspondence necessarily. Also, and maybe even a bigger concern to us, are verb forms. Ethiopic is capable of expressing only a very limited measure of the information that's contained in a Greek verb form. And this is critical because our variant relates to a verb in the Greek text, and the difference between two different Greek verbs. I say the basis correction is to correct it to be a Greek verb, whereas the other proposal is a Greek adjective, I believe. So the, let's see, yes, Algo note says, the fiasco of his attempt is recognized by all serious students of history. Quite right. But they did actually do a good cleanup of his mess up, I think. They pulled back nearly everything. I don't know if any of the manuscripts of that survived. If they did, they'd probably be extremely valuable for historical reasons. I don't know what extremely valuable constitutes in that field, but something. Anyway, coming back to the Ethiopic. There's much less information in Ethiopic verbs than in Greek verb forms. And more specifically, when it comes to the question of the time of the verb, the Ethiopic verb has no reference to time. It indicates only whether an action is regarded as perfect or complete or incomplete, imperfect. And this is a big problem for Nick Sayer's underlying theory, which is that there's three times mentioned here in the text, past, present, and future. When Ethiopic doesn't map well in its times to Greek times. And we're going to see how this plays out in more detail as we go on. But ultimately, the problem is, we'll see this in attempts at translating from Ge'ez to Latin, where we run into this problem. Latin has similar flexibility to Greek, not as much maybe, but similar to Greek, but Ethiopic doesn't. So we have this like kind of almost back translation from Ge'ez to Latin. Unfortunately, it would be kind of handy to just have back translation to Greek, but that's not how it was done generally. But anyway, let's continue on here. So here's just a snippet of the discussion of time. It has no reference to time, just whether or not it's complete or incomplete. And the verb to be has its own issues. In fact, there's a separate section just on the verb to be, and even its use as a copula is just passed over. There's something similar, I think, in Russian, maybe. You can just jump over the verb to be if you're using it in this copula sense. But also that creates problems when you're trying to back translate. Did the Greek have a copula form of the verb to be there or not? Is it just skipped over? And there's various ways this is handled. He gives some examples from the Gospels, most all from Matthew, I think. And there's also another problem, which is that there are no participles in Ethiopic that align with Greek, except for the perfect passive participle. But the perfect passive participle in Greek isn't one of the ones that we're interested in, but we are interested in whether there are two or three participles in the underlying Greek text for Revelation 16:5, and Ethiopic's not going to be able to capture that detail as such. So we're going to have to get to it in an indirect way. Dillman himself, in Crichton's translation, explains the issue with the time of the verbs. So you can read about that there if you're interested. Actually, it goes on. I posted all here. Some of the formatting is a little bit amok because of the mobile formatting of this text. You can read on your own time. I'm not going to read all those pages. Likewise, issues associated with these are the two verbs that have to do with being in Ethiopic. One of them is actually used in Revelation 16:5, but again, this is dealing with their copula usage, and we don't have to, or connecting words usage, same idea. Well, we don't have to get into it much here, but the point is this there are additional issues specifically with this verb in Ethiopic. Nickum in 2017 describes the substantial work that's been done since Hoffman, and he states that Hoffman's verdict that none of the extant witnesses examined preserves unadulterated the text of the initial translation, the so-called Aksumite Bible, still holds true, and that Arabic influence is present in every manuscript. So what Nickum is saying here, not Nick Sayers, but Nickum in his Apocalypse Now article, he's saying, Aksumite relates to the ancient capital of Ethiopia, which was Aksuma. Anyway, the Aksumite Bible, or the original Beza Bible. This one, it's hard to get back to it because it's been corrupted by introduction of readings from Arabic. And unfortunately, Arabic is wildly different than the Greek at Revelation 16:5. It has something like eternal instead of literally translating at all. So we don't know to what extent the Arabic has had an influence on this particular issue. It's really hard to unring that particular bell. But what about the Ethiopic text that we do have? We can wring our hands all we want about, wouldn't it be lovely if we had an uncorrupted Ethiopic text? But since we don't, let's just deal with the text we have. There are five passages of interest to us. They're of interest to us because they are related by Nick. They're related by others who see the connection between the one who is and was being mentioned in each of these places, either in that form or who was and is. But either way, in all five of these places, that that aspect is mentioned, who is and was. And let's see. So, given all these challenges about participles, times, and specifically in I, we'll just consider all these passages together. So, what I did in this article, and I'm just going to breeze through most of this, what I've done in the article, if you're interested to read it in more detail, please feel free. I've gone through the sources I could find, starting with the 1548 Peter the Ethiopian Bible. And I've just snipped out the sections that are relevant. So this is Revelation 1:4. Here's Revelation 1:8, 4:8, 11:17, 16:5. Then Walton's Polyglot at the same places. Then Platt in 1830, his edition in various places. And then finally Hoffman's 1967 in the same places. And the summary, I'll give you the summary of these. I also compared the Bible in Geese and the Concordance of the Ethiopian Bible, which are some electronic resources that are out there. And after doing these comparisons, I just kind of looked at each verse, what are the relevant portions of the text, and I just compared the readings. They're not all the same. Even the what I thought might be the same initially, the Bible in Geese and the Concordance of the Ethiopian Bible, I thought those might be the same, but there's actually a small difference at Revelation 16:5. I don't think I'll bore everyone with a detailed description of all these things, except to point out that the differences at Revelation 1:4 are small, are small among these versions. There's one prefix in one word that's omitted by Walton's and the 1548. There's the reason for that is probably because it's an expansive reading which has this Geese word, whereas the Platt Hoffman texts don't have that word at all. And therefore this prefix, which is included in the first word, is not included in the second word in Walton's Polyglot, whereas it is both of these prefixes are included together in the one word that's found in Platt and Hoffman. I don't know, this might be boring for people if I get too much into the weeds. But again, there's not huge differences at 1:8, except that at 1:8, and I don't know why, but the presumably to harmonize with 1:4, this word has been included at 1:8 by the two online electronic resources, but it's not found in the printed texts. Revelation 4:8, here are they all in one place, they all were the same, at least in the relevant portion of the text. But note that the relevant phrase that's of interest here has now shrunk to just two words in Geese, whereas previously there's three words in Geese, and before that, again, three words in Geese, three words at 1:4 and 1:8, down to two in 4:8, and then again two in 11:17. And the only real difference here is that Walton's seems to have not properly vocalized this particular letter. You'll see there's a slight difference from this one. It's really small. And it might even be my eyesight that's the issue, not Walton. It's hard for me to read Walton's text. The font is very small. The scan is not perfect quality. And, you know, it is what it is. And then there's there's this issue of this, whether or not to add this second person singular masculine here, which they do add at Revelation 11:17, and Platt adds, but the I call it a prefix. It should really be a suffix. I probably should correct that as well. So things to correct. I'll have to go back over this and make those corrections. Then when we come to Revelation 16:5, you'll notice I've excerpted a longer section. It includes those same two words we were talking about. If you'll notice, there's a small difference because of this character, but that's that second person masculine singular suffix that I was talking about before. These are largely the same words. This has another issue, but if you look at like Walton's here or Hoffman's here, the only difference is this suffix. And this is the one place where there was a difference between the Bible in Geese and the CEB. So let's see. So what about Latin? So we talked about the Geese, but not all of us speak Geese. I'm one of those non-Geese speakers, but Latin is a lot more familiar. Lots more people speak Latin. And there are three that I know of Latin translations of Geese texts that are out there that are professionally done. Loftus is one, Bode is another, Hoffman is the third, and they are all different. So there are similarities, there's differences. I've summarized them here. Loftus 1657, provide his Latin translation of the relevant text with snippets so you can confirm and check. Same thing with Bode, and same thing with Hoffman. So I won't belabor that point, but you'll notice with Hoffman that there's a lot of notes, but that's because it's a critical edition. So in summary, if you see Revelation 1:4, qui est et erit, qui venit et venturus est, you'll notice it's a little bit different from what Bode has, which is a little bit different from what Hoffman has. Hoffman has these parenthetical versions added, which kind of give more of the connotation, which I think is a good point, but not necessarily a literal reading. Bode is supposed to be an improved translation as compared to Loftus, but Bode is inconsistent. Geese is the same at Revelation 1:4 and 8, and yet his translation of fuit here and est, but with fuit in parentheses here, is different. Et erit here, but erit goes into parentheses here, and erat becomes the main text. And then down in 4:8, he just switched. There's no more parentheses. Qui is put in as a helper word, but ultimately there's a lot of confusion because his translation seems to be translating the same Geese words in different ways in different places, and it doesn't seem to have a good justification for it. It's an interesting read. But ultimately, I'm not won over by his points. But what he's highlighting, what his translation highlights is, notice this fuit is different from est. Est is it is. Fuit is it was. Erit is it will be. So I've done more here for those who are interested. You can go through erat, by the way, was. He has here as which is and was or will be. He's all over the place in terms of his translation. I'm not saying that it makes him wrong, but I'm just saying that there's a lack of consistency, and that's frustrating to someone who's trying to get an exact translation across. Hoffman is more expansive. He puts lots of these further explanations. By the way, this incorruptus, I don't know how in the world he gets incorruptus instead of rectus here, but it is what it is. That's what he put. So you can check it out as well. I have snippets if you're interested to read those details. So I ended up creating my own, and I don't claim to be a professional translator, but I ended up creating my own translation to summarize the 1548 text versus the critical text, meaning Hoffman's text, not meaning the critical lesson on 28 or something like that. And I put the English on one side and the Geese on the right. And you can see like the main difference is this, which comes is in the 1548, but not in the critical text. So it's an added word. And I went with which is and will be, not easily, but based on the predominance of the way it was translated, both by different translators and in different places. But it seems to be the best way to render something that's not easy to render back into English from Geese. So I did the best I could, but that is what it is. So what about 1:8? Well, 1:8 is the same. Both the critical text and 1548 are the same. So I just made one translation. And I went again, because I said that I thought this is the best translation of these words in 1:4. The same words should be translated the same way in a later place. And so I've so translated them. The same is true about Revelation 4:8 and Revelation 11:17. Notice that, by the way, in Revelation 4:8, although the Greek that we have has a form of to come, there isn't one here in Revelation 4:8 in the Ethiopic. And there isn't one at 11:17, like the critical text, which doesn't have it at 11:17. But unlike the 4:8 and 11:17, these are places where the Ethiopic contradicts the received text in terms of having this form of the verb to come here. When we turn to 16:5, the difference is small between the two texts. It's just whether or not to put the word them here at the end, and that's just reflected in this single character, which is a suffix that would provide the them. The 1548 includes it, the critical doesn't include it, but that's the difference. And thus the just you are, O Lord, and right, who are and will be, thus you have judged them. That's the English translation of the Geese text, as best I can give it, based on the help of the Latin translations that came before and all the Geese references and so forth I could find. So this is my best attempt to render the relevant portion of Revelation 16:5. There is more before just, is the angel of the waters says, comes before this. This is part of a quotation. But anyway, this is just the relevant portion. Maybe I should clarify that as well. We'll see. But anyway, so coming down here, comparison between Revelation 16:5 and the Geese. So we're coming towards the conclusion of this survey or analysis. When we look at the Greek at Revelation 16:5 and the Geese at Revelation 16:5, we need to see what happens. So based on Greek manuscripts, there's two kind of most likely readings. One is this one, which is Ho'on Kai Ho'en Kai Ho'ozias. A second one, which is the one the critical text uses, I believe, which is Ho'on Kai Ho'en Ho'ozias, without this Kai. And then there's Beza's reading I put here as well, Ho'on Kai Ho'en Kai Ho'esomenos. So in other places where Ho'on Kai Ho'en appear in Greek, so the other places where this appears in Greek are Revelation 1:4, Revelation 1:8, and Revelation 11:17. And a very similar phrase, which is just Ho'en Kai Ho'on, which you can see is like the same. Ho'on is here, it's before the Kai, and Ho'en is after the Kai, and in Revelation 4:8, the order is reversed. this phrase, whether found in this, you know, this form or in the opposite form, in all of those places, Gies uniformly translates using this expression, which means which is and will be. Or at least I say it means that. If it doesn't mean that, maybe it means which was and won't, and which was and was, or which was and will be, or whatever it is. But anyway, it's this phrase. This is the phrase that equates to this statement. It doesn't, the English, which is the correct English translation, is somewhat of a moot point because we're trying to figure out what's the Gies that corresponds to the Greek. So the English, you know, we could take it or leave it, but this is the corresponding Gies to this phrase. But the challenge here is the only difference between these phrases, between this phrase and what's found in Revelation 16:5 is that kaf is added, which I mentioned here. This kaf is added, and that's, you'll notice that's not here, but it's added, it just makes it you. So the angel says to, the angel is saying to God, you who are, instead of which is, like a third person reference. He's speaking to God, so he's using the second person in this translation. Now that doesn't map up well to the Greek, because the Greek's using participles with articles. Gies doesn't have articles. It doesn't have participles that work the same way as Greek participles. So it's kind of a rough and ready translation, but anyway, we have this, at least we have this phrase that we can say in the other places that it's found, it means this, but that's common to all three. And then it's the suffix that's added. There's no way to suggest that it has a different Greek text based on the suffix. That suffix seems to represent the, and I'm terrible at pronouncing this, but this you are, the Greek word for you are, ae. Which is immediately before this text. So, well, that, therefore, this is a direct address. It's saying you who are, not you, and then talking the third person about God. So, how will we distinguish between these three candidates as to which one of these, if any, this Gies supports, the Gies being either the critical or the 1548. And they're substantially the same because the part that's different is just this word them, judge them or just judged. But which one does it support? Well, interestingly, what helps us out is this word. And I'm purposely not saying the word out loud, although you can see it's apparently pronounced Yerte, if I'm reading this correctly, this schwa sound, yerte, I don't know. But apparently yerte with this wa at the beginning, so wa yerte, and the wa just means and where yerte means right. Now, I say right because that's what the Latin translation, or the Latin word rectus was used, which means right. Some had ac rectus, which means and right, or some had et rectus, which also means and right. but right isn't a word that lines up with Isomenos, and it doesn't line up with Hosios. Not directly, but one is much closer than the other, and I'll explain how that's the case. Why is one much closer than the other? So if you look at the comparative dictionary of Gies for this particular entry, you can see that it could mean straight, straightened, be right, be righteous, be just, be truthful, be sincere, become established, be restored, be well-ordered, be successful, prosper, be prosper, whatever that means, and used with indirect object suffix pronouns, it seemed right to me. Then there's related words. You can see there's nuances of meaning that come up with various things, but among the nuances of words, upright, straight, right, just, righteous, honest, true, correct, proper, level, even orthodox. So it can have this gives you some sense of the overall meaning, including righteousness and equity and judgment, truth and truthfulness. And you can see why this equity and judgment, righteousness, right, orthodox, correct, all these type of meanings, which rectus somewhat conveys, but not fully, how that's captured. There's actually another little piece here of, because it's comparative dictionary, so you can see some other discussion of other languages. But notice that the word can have a range of meanings. In this case, my analysis is, I believe the translator from Greek to Gies thought that the Greek was to be understood in terms of a phrase that says this, kai hosias hoti tauta ekrinas, and the holy, because you have judged thus. And therefore he's translating this as holy, hosias, as right or true, or even as righteous, in view of the correctly judging. In other words, he understood this phrase of Greek, or what he broke it out as a phrase of Greek, to be saying that God is just and God is right in his judgments because he is judging correctly. And therefore, rather than using a hosias, which usually means more holy, he has instead used a word that means right, rather than a word that would be more typically expressed as holy. Now, what about hosias? What does hosias mean? Usually it relates to being holy, and you know, that's pretty much the range of the limits of that meaning, of the meaning of the word. Is it unreasonable for him to associate being holy and being righteous and being right? Well, we often make a similar kind of conflation between holy and righteous in English. It's not impossible that somebody without having a perfect understanding of Greek could understand that being holy, it means like following God's law perfectly or something like this. And therefore, if he thinks that it's following the law perfectly is being holy, you could understand how that could lead someone to using, especially if he's seeing this as a phrase of you're holy because you've judged thus, that he would be thinking that this means that the person is righteous because they judged rightly. And that would be an explanation of how he could end up with the translation he ended up with. Now, how you would get it from a future tense to right, I don't see. I don't see any logical path there. It's not, and this is key, it's not an exact translation. And however, if my analysis is correct, and I think it is, the Gies here is a witness to reading number one above, which is, well, I've summarized it here. Hon kai hoen kai ho otsis. So while this is not the Nestle-Aland 28 reading, because the Nestle-Aland 28 reading omits this kai, it's supportive of a variant that exists in a substantial minority of the Greek manuscripts. Also keep in mind, it's not necessarily an exact translation. So kai may have even not been present in the exemplar and just supplied to provide meaning. So translators do this. Sometimes they supply words just to make the meaning more clear. And some people have said that the without the chi, it's hard to understand the text. So it may or may not represent one versus two, but it's either one or two. It's not erkomenos here instead of, or isomenos here instead of osios. It's just not, there's no way to get to isomenos from what we have in the actual text here. So that's my conclusion. I know the TR defenders will not necessarily welcome this analysis. And it, while it's true that the literal geese includes a future form of the verb to be, it does. This is something we have to acknowledge. This literally does have a future sense to it. But even though that's true, it's inappropriate to rely on this as as allegedly serving to witness to Beza's text. The best understanding of the text to which it witnesses is the one I just identified. It's not a literal translation of that underlying text, but there's excellent reasons why it's not a literal translation of that underlying text. Reasons that are grounded in the difference between Geese and Greek and a general willingness of the Geese translator to try to convey the sense without being concerned with being overly literal. TR advocates will also not be impressed by the fact that the Ethiopic at Revelation 11:17 witnesses the shorter majority and critical text, or a shorter reading at Revelation 4:8, which the critical text doesn't adopt. Ultimately, while interesting, the Ethiopic text is not dispositive for New Testament textual studies. There remains work to be done in advancing Hoffman's work from the 1960s using the new manuscripts that have come to light since then, but I don't anticipate seeing a significantly different result as to this specific reading. Additionally, I would add that this literal translation sword has two edges. So while this is a future form of the verb to be, it is not literally ho isomenos. If you back translated it to Greek, you would not get ho isomenos, even though that also includes a future form of the verb to be. So saying, well, in English, the shall be or will be is part of the translation, it doesn't mean that the two things are the same. It just means that there's an overlap in the English translation of those two things. Finally, I think it's unreasonable to suppose that Beza had access to and was considering the 1548 Giza text, or Giza text. Peter the Ethiopian, also called Tesfas Zion, and there's a link here for more discussion. He acknowledged the challenges of printing the text and the quotation translated, of course, to English. Those who composed it could not read Ethiopic, and we who read Ethiopic knew not how to compose. Sort of a blind helping the blind project. But he did a remarkably good job considering that. And it's true that, and I don't have the right pronunciation here, but Galawados, the king of Ethiopia and the Pope of Rome at the time, consented to this project. But there's nothing to suggest to us that the scholars of the time, such as Beza, had access to the readings of this text or consulted it for their edition. And I welcome any feedback or any evidence from any of the TR advocates on this point. Find a place, in any place, where Beza cites the Ethiopic and says, well, the Ethiopic says such and such here. If he does, at least that would open the possibility that Beza was citing here. But ultimately, when it comes to whether or not Beza cited it, now, if you want to play like the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon game, you can connect Beza to Peter the Ethiopian that way. And I think it's a pretty short chain, like Beza, Tremelius, either to the Pope that authorized this, or even maybe with Tremelius, but had some direct involvement in this publication. But the people who helped Peter the Ethiopian didn't read Ethiopic, according to Peter the Ethiopian, who did. And he didn't know how to print. The printers knew how to print. He knew how to read. And it was a difficult and challenging project, but they got through it. And it's impressive, but it ultimately just serves as a support for the reading Hosias. It does not support the reading Isomenos, even though there's a future form there in the text. So that's my little research project, such as it is. I hope that I'll have a chance to polish that early next week and fill out any of the errors that I identified during this presentation. But I do appreciate people listening along. Let me see through the comments. I don't think I'll get a lot of pushback from folks. Geese is not on everybody's mind. Hi to Fred Beal. Hi to Algo. I think I said hello before. Hi to Michelle Sherry KJV. Hi to Jason Page. Let's see, lots of chats in the chat, which is what it's for. Back and forth. Let's see, just going through, hoping not to miss anything important. Wonder what the future holds for TFan and Dan and writings. Well, we'll see. I don't think we have anything specific planned. Might be fun to do a joint book with Dan on Calvinism issues, some kind of, you know, opposing views or something like that. Or maybe on free grace, which we have to argue on the same side. Let's see. Is there anything that Nick Sayers believes that ends up being true? Yeah, sure, lots. Yeah. Nick takes his study seriously. He's not always right about everything, but he takes the study seriously and he gets a lot of things right. And I appreciate his integrity. There was some issue that had come up where I had said he made a mistake. At first, he didn't think that he had, but when I showed him that he had, he actually, to use his words, ate some humble pie and acknowledged it. And I appreciate that. And I think at the time I said, I think it's just an honest mistake. And I still to this day believe it was. So, you know, everybody makes mistakes. He doesn't claim to be, you know, the next Erasmus, nor do I. And anyway, neither of us is infallible. So, yeah. And actually, I would say one thing I like about Nick is that he will bring up point. He'll do the research that sometimes the serious scholars aren't doing. And part of that's because he has different motivations than the serious scholars, but also sometimes because the scholars just kind of, unless it's a point that they are specifically investigating for their specific work, they tend to ride on the what's been done before. So while that can be a useful way of saving time and energy, then it's not always right. And there are times when the scholars just, they somewhere along the way, a myth developed and people just followed the myth. And unfortunately, in this case, one of those myths might be this idea that the Ethiopic supports Revelation 16:5. It's not right. There is a future form of a verb there in the Ethiopic, but it nevertheless doesn't support the reading. So that's something that Hoskier suggested. I don't agree with Hoskier, and I think the reason Hoskier suggested it is because he read Latin, and he read the Latin text, and the Latin text, he felt, provided the support he needed for that particular point. And Hoskier is a serious, impressive scholar. I just don't think he was giving this the level of attention or detail that we're giving it now. We're examining this under a microscope, and we're spending hours and hours on one particular point, as opposed to him having to do an entire book and looking at hundreds of manuscripts and dozens of versions and church fathers and all these other things. And the fact that he makes a tiny little mistake, you know, it's hardly a criticism of Hoskier that he could make a mistake. He's just human as well. Much better scholar than I'll ever be, but nevertheless, still. Let's see. So just looking through, I see there's additional comments debating Calvinism 2.0. I don't know. Well, anyway, thank you all for listening. I'll try to keep this relatively short. It's been about an hour and a half on one single version, on one single point. That brings us, by the way, in terms of this book, it brings us to the end of chapter 3. Next up is chapter 4. And it's 4.1, Tremelius, Junius, and Beza. That's the next part. And this I may have a little bit of delay getting started on, both because I have an upcoming debate, two upcoming debates. I would like to do a little bit more research on a few of these points, especially on some of these reformers. I've started doing some of that research already, but I'd like to do more. And chapter 4 is the last chapter before Nick's conclusion. So now it's an important chapter, but the Ethiopic was the last of what I was thinking will be the most substantive materials. So I hope that Nick and I are advancing the scholarship on these points, not just repeating the same, lines back and forth. Oh, Hosker says this. Well, the Nestle 28 says that. Hope we're actually pushing things forward. If Nick finds mistakes in what I've made, I'm happy to improve, correct, and so forth. And I appreciate that he feels the same way. I hope that we're making progress. He has mentioned in one of his reply videos some material from Thomas Aquinas, which I don't have handy, and I would like to review even before I get to chapter 4. So I may do, if I can find, well, I can go back to what he presented. And if I can find it and locate what he's talking about, maybe I can do another episode on that. But it's probably going to be a couple of weeks until we come back to this series. So, however, God willing, this week we'll be doing a lot of material on Romans 5, especially 12 through 21, and its connection to original sin. So if you're interested, look forward to that. That's the plan. I hope that it goes according to plan. And again, thank you all. Thanks, Alco, Michelle, Jason, Patrick Brandon, and I think I mentioned Alco already, and Fred Beal. Thank you all. And if I didn't mention you again, I apologize. I'm skimming through as quickly as I can. Debate on October 28th, and then again the following Saturday as well. So October 28th is the original sin, and Romans 5, and then the following one is the imputation of Christ's righteousness. So thank you, and God be with you.